I have a question or three about Jack Pfeffer and his exposing of the sport in 1934 to the New York Times. Did his expose go national, or was it limited to the New York area, thus protecting the majority of developing territories? What was the aftermath of this, and what's Jim's opinion on it, considering on one hand, it's wrestling's golden years, and on the other, it's exposing the business?
Well, as I understand, it was picked up by wire services, and feel free to jump in on this if you want to, but it was picked up by wire services. It ran places it didn't. It didn't get, there was no television. There were wrestling magazines in existence at that time. I actually have some from that era, and I don't think they printed it. There was little wrestling news on the radio. So basically it did go places, but it was a little more controlled. And also at that point, until The Fall Guys was written in 1937, which used a lot of that information and had got, I think, Marcus Griffin on the trail of it to begin with, it did actually, from what I understand, hurt the business eventually, because things happened slower in those days. Think about this. By the time that you hear about something in California that happened in New York, even on the wire services, it'd be, you know, days or weeks or whatever, right?
Yeah.
Unless it was huge radio news, but or on the newsreel when you went to the movies, if you went to the movies. It was harder for a bunch of people, the mainstream of America, to hear about anything back then than it is now. So the way I understand it is, after that became the book The Fall Guys and got circulated around, and also World War II came in. A business in a lot of places from the late 30s until the debut of the network television era was down. There was no wrestling in Madison Square Garden between 1939 and 1951. The big heel draw during the World War II years was Wild Bill Longson, and he's still one of the top 10 box office attractions of all time. And but mainly in St. Louis and the Midwest, where wrestling still had a good name. In St. Louis, we've talked about his string where he drew over 10,000 people to every show in St. Louis for like 5 years, which was, you know, was amazing. And this was with no television. But that is what led everybody in the wrestling business to, that was the common wisdom from then on, that an expose is going to hurt business, because that expose did come out in the 30s, which led to the book, which led to, at the same time that the economy was recovering from the Depression, where wrestling had been huge, and especially Jim Londo, still the all-time biggest box office attraction, he'd been drawing ballpark crowds during the Depression. Now the Depression is over with. Yes, we're in the war, but wrestling sucks in a lot of places. Was it the war and the fact that a lot of the talent was in the service, or did the expose take, or was it both? Probably. But that was the conventional wisdom from then on out, that an expose hurt. And local exposés in different places at different times hurt different territories. Now, he says where the territories were forming, the territories weren't forming in the 30s. They wouldn't form till the 50s. There were booking offices, the Nashville booking office, then would send talent to a variety of promoters in their area, in that geographic area. Or the Dallas booking office, or this, that booking office, but there weren't really territories as we knew them until television and after that they started for us. But then exposés would hurt the local.
Exposés would hurt, but also Jack Pfeffer would now have a reputation, which he seemed to love, where he was going to go into a territory, and if you didn't work with him, if you didn't take whoever he was booking, if you gave him any problem, he was going to go to the newspaper and expose your business.
Yes, he was in the wrestling business in some way or another for 35 more years after he did that. He originally was like, he was a little, you know, crow-faced, you know, Russian that came over with the opera company, right? But he'd gotten into wrestling in the 20s and as far as promotion. He was never an athlete or physical, but as far as being a promoter and a manager, he managed the Fargos. He's the one that booked the Fargos in Tennessee and in New York and all the places that they went. And Jackie Fargo said Jack Pfeffer always made him a ton of money. But at the same time, he was from then on known as the outlaw promoter. If you didn't cut him in As you said, he'd go to the newspaper. That's why when he went to Tennessee in the 60s one time and had girl wrestlers and said, if you don't book my girls for 2 weeks, I go to the newspaper and expose to business. Christine Jarrett in the meeting with Gulas and him said something to the effect of you might just end up dead. And there is it in the Jack Pfeffer collection in Notre Dame. There is a note handwritten with a, like on a Nashville or either Gulas Welch booking office or a Nashville hotel letterhead. It says in Pfeffer's handwriting, this is when Christine Jarrett threatened to kill me. but that's what he would do. And he tried to, worked his way in or bullied his way in or connived his way into the booking, being the booking agent for Madison Square Garden a couple times in the '50s. He was always, he's the guy who pioneered the sound alike names. If he's running opposition and Bobo Brazil is over in Detroit, you on Jack Pfeffer's show, you get Hobo Brazil or Bummy Rogers.
Haystacks Muldoon.
Haystacks Muldoon. And it's so it's kind of fitting that while the Fall Guys details the blueprint for the modern day wrestling business as far as the Toots Mont inventing the finish and the program and the angle and Jack Pfeffer, who was the source for a lot of the material in the first major expose, when he got mad because he got aced out of the New York office, he became the prototype for every outlaw promoter for the next 50 years. It all kind of, everything that we see or have seen for all that time in wrestling started in the 30s at about the same time.